Welcome to Sabbath School. Today we're going to be talking about the investigative judgment. This is a doctrine. In fact, it's even a phrase that is not well received by most other people who aren't Seventh-day Adventists, and even today by many who claim to be Seventh-day Adventists. The idea of having an investigative judgment, a judgment that investigates the records of individuals, is not one that's liked by people who want to have their way in the way that they live. They want to be able to live any way they want, and then they can just pass on into heaven by simply asking for justification, that God will forgive their sins and that they don't have to make changes in their lives. Even within Adventism, we see a change in the way we present this doctrine and even the way we describe the doctrine. Today is hardly called the investigative judgment by most Adventist people anymore. It's given the phrase pre-Advent judgment. Pre-Advent judgment, something that happens before Jesus comes. But today we want to look at what the Bible says and also what the Spirit of Prophecy says about the investigative judgment. So if you're following along with me in the presentational slides, we'll go ahead to the next one. And we're going to begin, and the first part of this study today is going to be on the judgment in prophecy and in type. And we want to go to a place in the Old Testament where we see a description of this judgment scene given, and that's in Daniel 7. I want you to get your Bible out, and I want you to be ready to turn to these different texts with me. And the first one's in Daniel chapter 7, and we're going to read verses 9 and 10. Now, Daniel chapter 7 is a great chapter that involves one of those parallel lines of successive kingdoms in Bible prophecy, but this one takes us further beyond simply the kingdoms of Babylon, Medo-Persia, Grecian Rome, but this takes us all the way down through the ten toes and into the time of the judgment. And Daniel here writes in verse 9, chapter 7, verse 9 and 10, I beheld till the thrones were cast down, or the margins says as thrones were placed. It's not that God just cast something down casually. They were placed or put in special position. And it says, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousand thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were open. The Bible says that there's going to come a time, according to this prophecy, and the indication in the time flow, as you study through this prophecy, it happens sometime after the rise of these ten kingdoms, these ten horns, and that this is going to be a judgment where the Ancient of Days did sit, and one like the Son of Man comes to him. Now, who do you think the Ancient of Days could be?
God.
That'd be God the Father, wouldn't it? That's right. And, of course, one like the Son of Man is Jesus Christ. In our next slide, we have a statement from the book Great Controversy, page 479. And that statement says, thus, referring to these verses, thus was presented to the prophet's vision the great and solemn day when the characters and the lives of men should pass in review before the judge of all the earth, and to every man should be rendered according to his works. The Ancient of Days is God the Father. Says the psalmist, before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Psalms 90, verse 2. It is He, the source of all being, and the fountain of all law, that is to preside in the judgment. The holy angels as ministers and witnesses in number 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands attend this great tribunal. Now we know that this movement is a movement from the holy to the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And when we think about the type and the antitype, we need to keep something in mind. And that is that in the type, it was a pattern of the great reality in heaven. But of course, not everything could exactly parallel. We notice if you study, for instance, the sanctuary in the wilderness, that it was a set size. But for instance, when Solomon created his temple, it was much larger. The proportions were the same, but it was much larger, much more grand. But in the heavenly sanctuary, it is so grand, and it's so large in its proportion, that 10,000 times 10,000 angels can be there to uphold or to see what is going on. Now, can you think of a New Testament prophetic message that announces that a time of the judgment has arrived? Can you think of anything in the Bible that speaks about a judgment hour that has actually arrived? And you know, the Bible speaks about judgment in many places, about the coming judgment, but there is in fact a text that should be at the very heart and soul of every Seventh-day Adventist person. And that's in Revelation chapter 14. And let's turn there to Revelation chapter 14, and we're going to read verses 6 and 7. This is the beginning of what we call the three angels' messages. And this is, in fact, the message of the first angel. And John says, I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come. And worship Him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of water. He says that there's a judgment hour message, and this judgment hour message, it involves the gospel, the everlasting gospel. Because only those who accept and partake of the everlasting gospel are going to be found faithful and worthy and acquitted in this judgment. But Paul spoke about, when he was speaking one time, he spoke of righteousness and temperance and judgment to come. But now John says there's a time, prophetically looking ahead, when he says the judgment has come. Now, can you think maybe of an Old Testament prophetic message that announces a future time of the judgment? Something in the Old Testament that would give us a timeline or an understanding of when we could understand the beginning of this judgment. Can you think of one? What do you think of? Can you think of something maybe in the Old Testament, maybe in the book of Daniel, that would pinpoint that very time of the judgment? And I think we can see that in Daniel chapter 8 and verse 14. And he said unto me, In the 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Here we have, beloved, the one great text that helps us as we compare this text and we put it in the context of Daniel 8 and then Daniel chapter 9, we can understand when the judgment was to begin, that there was a 2,300-day period. And in this 2,300-day period, there were certain events that were going to happen, and that will be another study. It's not our study for today. But you know that this 2,300-day period, it began with a 70-week period. And that period was to begin with the command to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem. And we know that historically, and we know according to the book of Ezra, in the 7th chapter of Ezra, that this decree went forth from Artaxerxes in the year 457 B.C. And extending down from that time, 2,300 years, each day for a year, Ezekiel 4:6, Numbers 14:34, we come to the place of October 22, 1844. In the book Great Controversy, on page 424, we read, Both the prophecy of Daniel 8:14, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed, and the first angel's message, Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come, pointed to Christ's ministration in the most holy place, to the investigative judgment, and not to the coming of Christ for the redemption of His people and the destruction of the wicked. There's a good bit in the Bible about the coming of Christ, about the destruction of the wicked, and we'll look at some of those later today. But here is a specific coming, and this is the coming of the Son of Man to the Ancient of Days to begin this last great judgment work. Now, in the ancient typical service, can you think of the ceremony that resulted in the cleansing of both the people and the cleansing of the sanctuary? Was there a service that did both? Maybe someone can chat in a response here. But There was the Day of Atonement. That's right. I actually knew that. The Day of Atonement. And let's turn, if we could, to Leviticus 16. Leviticus 16. And I want you to notice verses 29 through 34. After going through the procedures on the Day of Atonement and what was going to happen, it says in verse 29, And this shall be a statute forever unto you, that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, ye shall afflict your souls, and do no work at all, whether it be one of your own country, or a stranger that sojourneth among you. For on that day shall the priest make an atonement for you, to cleanse you, that ye may be clean from all your sins before the Lord. It shall be a Sabbath of rest unto you, and ye shall afflict your souls by a statute forever. Now, he just said before they were going to have to afflict their souls, but now he says it again. And anytime you see something repeated in the Bible, beloved, there's a reason for that. And God is trying to emphasize to us that this is a time of affliction of soul, when we're searching our souls, looking for sin so that sin can be expelled from the soul. And the priest whom he shall anoint and whom he shall consecrate to minister in the priest's office in his father's stead shall make the atonement and shall put on the linen clothes, even the holy garments. And notice what else he makes an atonement for and cleanses. And he shall make an atonement for the holy sanctuary. And he shall make an atonement for the tabernacle of the congregation and for the altar. And he shall make an atonement for the priests and for all the people of the congregation. And this shall be an everlasting statute unto you, to make an atonement for the children of Israel for all their sins once a year. And he did as the Lord commanded Moses. And so there was an atonement made. There was a cleansing made. Now, in this particular chapter, the phraseology is a little different than other places. We think of the first apartment of the heavenly sanctuary as being usually called the
holy
place. And we think of the second apartment as being called the most holy place, sometimes the Holy of Holies. But here, in verse 16, and then over here also in verse 33, you have the holy sanctuary. It says he makes an atonement for it. In verse 16, it says he makes an atonement for the holy place as supplied, but a holy place. But then it speaks about the tabernacle of the congregation, and that represents then the holy place, and then the altar represents the courtyard. So all three portions were ministered to in this service, and they all received an atonement. There was a cleansing made for the sanctuary and for the people. Now, continuing in Great Controversy, it says, as anciently the sins of the people were by faith placed upon the sin offering and through its blood transferred in figure to this earthly sanctuary, so in the new covenant the sins of the repentant are by faith placed upon Christ and transferred, in fact, to the heavenly sanctuary. And as the typical cleansing of the earthly was accomplished by the removal of the sins by which it had been polluted, so the actual cleansing of the heavenly is to be accomplished by the removal or blotting out of the sins which are there recorded. But, continuing it says, but before this can be accomplished, there must be an examination of the books of record to determine who, through repentance of sin and faith in Christ, are entitled to the benefits of his atonement. The cleansing of the sanctuary, therefore, involves a work of investigation, a work of judgment. This work must be performed prior to the coming of Christ to redeem his people, for when he comes, his reward is with him to give to every man according to his works. Revelation 22:12. And that's from the Great Controversy, pages 421 and 422. Let's go to our next section. God's record of men and women's lives. These records are going to be examined. And let's notice a text again in Daniel chapter 7. We read this one earlier, but let's read it again. Daniel chapter 7 and verse 10. It says that a fiery stream issued and came forth before him. Thousand thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set. But something happens now that the judgment is set. It says, and the books were opened. There are books that are opened in this judgment. In Revelation chapter 20, we read about one of these books. Revelation chapter 20 and verse 12, particularly notice the last part. John says, and I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. So he says there are books, plural, and one is called the book of life. Now, when we think of a book, we think of something like the Bible. In fact, do you know what the Greek word for Bible is? It's Bible. It's biblion. The Greek word for biblion that we use, that we translate to get Bible today, but that word biblion simply means book. So when we say this is the Bible, it's the book. Or when we call it the Holy Bible, it's the holy book. But God says He had books. Books in heaven. Books of record. Now today we have different kinds of books. There were books in the times of John and the apostles. Today we have e-books, right? We have electronic books. And we have video records of things. I don't know exactly what the books of heaven are like. The Bible doesn't give us the exact details. But whatever they are, they somehow chronicle and record events, lives, deeds, things of this world. And we're going to see that here in just a minute. So what are some texts that speak about the books of heaven and what might be in them? So we're going to look at some of those Bible texts now. And the first one we're going to go to is Malachi 3:16. Malachi 3:16. We have a little picture accompanying this particular slide to help us to remember what it means. Malachi 3:16. Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament, so it shouldn't be too hard to find. It says, "Then they that feared the Lord spake oft one to another, and the Lord hearkened it and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before Him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon His name." And so there's a book of remembrance. And when we do good things, when we speak encouraging words to one another, that makes God happy, friends. And He puts that in His book of remembrance. And so that's one thing that the books of heaven speak about. The next one is Nehemiah 13:14. He says, "Remember me, O my God, concerning this, and wipe not out my good deeds that I have done for the house of my God and for the offenses thereof." He says, don't wipe out my good deeds. In other words, somewhere there's a record of His good deeds, the things that He has done to help other people or to speak about God's goodness. He says, please don't wipe those out. Psalms 56 and verse 8 is another one. Psalms 56 and verse 8. You probably know what this text is based on the picture. If you see the picture here, it looks like a little child with tears running down his eyes. Psalms 56 verse 8. "Thou tellest my wanderings. Put thou my tears in thy bottle. Are they not in thy book?" And so the tears, the sadness, the trials, the discouragements, He says, put these in thy book. And so God records all those things as well. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 14. Now while you're turning there, see a picture here, and that picture may not look familiar to you, but what that is, that's actually a satellite picture that was taken in 1962 of part of Cuba. And this is when the Soviet Union was installing thermonuclear missiles in Cuba. And the United States found out, and the Soviet Union and Cuba, they were trying to do this secretly. They didn't want people to know what was going on. They wanted to get this set up, and then they would announce it to the world once they had a finger on the trigger and they could pull it at any time. But the United States found these missile sites before they became operational, and so there ensued quite a struggle, international struggle over this. But they thought they were doing this without being detected at first. But notice what Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 14 says. It says, "God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil." And so anything that's done, whether we think it's in the light of daylight to men or not, doesn't matter. It's all going to be brought out, every secret thing in the judgment. Matthew chapter 12. Let's turn there now. And I have a picture of a book, and it was called Jew Jokes. They were jokes about Jewish people. But I ask you as Christians, is this really the kind of book or the kind of attitude that we would want? Let's see what Jesus says about something like this. In Matthew chapter 12 and verse 36, Jesus says, "But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned." And so, friends, all the things that we say and the things that we think, all the secret things, they're going to be brought to light in the judgment. And idle words, words that have no bearing on reality, and especially words that hurt and cut down other people, words that defame other people, this is wrong and we should not do those things, because they're going to come back in the judgment against us. 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 5 now. It says, "Therefore, judge nothing before the time until the Lord come, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the heart, and then shall every man have praise of God. So that's a little bit like our text in Ecclesiastes 12:14. The dark things, things that we think are done in a dark alley, those are going to come back someday, friends. And they're going to be all made very light. It's like going into a very dark place, but then someone suddenly flips on a switch and all the floodlights come on. And it's bright. And it's all going to become to light. Now, in Signs of the Times of July 31, 1901, we read this. God's law reaches the feelings and motives as well as the outward acts. It reveals the secrets of the heart, flashing light upon things before buried in darkness. God knows every thought, every purpose, every plan, every motive. The books of heaven record the sins that would have been committed had there been opportunity. And you might be thinking about that. You say, well, that just doesn't seem fair, God. I didn't do that. I thought about it, true. But I didn't do it. How can you hold that against me, God? But you remember what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount? He said, if I look on a woman to lust after her, he says, you've already committed adultery within her heart. If I think to do harm to my brother, I've already committed murder against him in my heart. Because you see, friends, it's the things in the heart that come out. And just simply because we're restrained from being able to commit those things or to do them, it doesn't mean that the sin's not in our heart already. So even the things that we would have done if we'd had opportunity, but didn't have the opportunity, those things will be held against us in the judgment. And it really is a warning to us to be careful how we allow our thoughts to go, because as the thoughts go, so will our actions so oftentimes. And we also had this statement in Signs of the Times, July 31st, 1901. It says, God will bring every work into judgment with every secret thing. By His law, He measures the character of every man. As the artist transfers to the canvas the features of the face, so the features of each individual character are transferred to the books of heaven. God has a perfect photograph of every man's character. And this photograph He compares with His law. He reveals to the man the defects that mar his life and calls upon him to repent and turn from his sin. Now, we've all seen some pretty good pictures, and we've all seen some pretty lousy pictures. And probably everybody today has heard the term Photoshop. Even if you don't run a computer, even if you don't have the program Photoshop, you probably have heard the term Photoshop. Oh, that picture, it was Photoshopped. That means simply it was altered, it was changed. It is said that you will not see a picture on any front cover of a magazine, any portrait of an individual that's not been Photoshopped some, where they take some of the wrinkles out here, they smooth out the blemishes there, they whiten the teeth, they make the lips redder, they do everything to enhance the portrait of the individual. But friends, God's books have no Photoshop to them. They are real, they are exact, and they are accurate to the pixel. And they will reveal the true story. In Review and Herald, September 22, 1891, it says this, in the books of heaven, our lives are as accurately traced as in the picture on the plate of the photographer. Not only are we held accountable for what we have done, but for what we have left undone. We are held to account for our undeveloped characters, our unimproved opportunities. So not only will we be held accountable for what we would have done if we'd had the opportunity, what we would have committed, but also for what we didn't do that we should have done, for the opportunities that weren't improved, for the characters that weren't developed. And you might say, you know, Brother Allen, you're making this sound really hard. You're making God's standards sound really high. And you know what? It is high. But it doesn't have to be hard if we yoke up with Jesus. Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is what?
Easy.
And my burden is light. So it doesn't have to be hard, friends. When you're in harmony with Christ, when atonement, that which brings you into harmony with God, when atonement happens in your life, friends, you're greatly pleased to do the will of God. It doesn't have to become a hardship. It becomes something we want to do. Now, what special book of register does God maintain in heaven? That's our next point. And we want to read that in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 3. Paul says, "And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers, whose names are in the book of life." And we read about this book of life in Revelation chapter 20 and verse 12 earlier. But let's go back to Revelation 20 again. In verse 15, he says, "And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." That makes it pretty serious, friends. If our names are not written in the Lamb's book of life, we will be cast into the lake of fire. In Revelation chapter 21 and verse 27, he says this, "And there shall in no wise enter into it," that is, into that holy city, "anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life." And so here we have a contrast. We have that which defiles, the abomination, and it's cast out. It goes to the lake of fire. But those who are written in the Lamb's book of life, friends, they will enter that holy city because they don't defile. Sin has been taken out of their lives. Now, in Signs of the Times of August 6, 1885, we read this. "When we become children of God, our names are written in the Lamb's book of life, and they remain there until the time of the investigative judgment. Then the name of every individual will be called, and his record examined by him who declares, 'I know thy works.'" And so our names are not just by default in the book of life. They have to be entered there. And they're entered there when we accept Christ, or we make a profession of acceptance of Christ. When we claim to be a Christian, God says, "Okay, this man claims to be mine. I put his name in my book of life." But we're going to see if it's worthy to stay there. In Great Controversy, page 480, it says, "The book of life contains the names of all who have ever entered the service of God." And so that's what the book of life does. Now, if God's going to examine this book of life, so where does this judgment then begin? Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 17. It says, "For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God?" And in fact, the judgment begins at the house of God. And really, in fact, it only deals, this first part, this investigative judgment, only deals with the house of God. Because no one who has, let me just put it this way, those who have never accepted Christ, they are by default not even present at this judgment. Their names don't even come up for review at this judgment. So the idea that we can just live however we want, as long as we have a good life and we don't do anything wrong, it doesn't matter that we accept Christ, it doesn't matter that we go to church, as long as we're a little better than we are bad, we're going to go to heaven, is wrong. It's wrong. We don't even come up for investigation in the judgment unless we make a profession of Jesus Christ, unless we claim to be Christians. In the book Great Controversy, again, page 480, and I'd just like to say this. If you will read the chapter on the investigative judgment, the chapter on the Holy of Holies, the chapter on facing life's record of the judgment, if you read those three or four chapters in that area, in the Great Controversy, friends, you won't be misled and you won't go wrong on this teaching. It's there. It's so plain. It's so clear. But on page 480 of Great Controversy, she says this, "In the typical service, only those who come before God with confession and repentance and whose sins through the blood of the sin offering were transferred to the sanctuary had a part in the service of the Day of Atonement. So in the great day of final atonement and investigative judgment, the only cases considered are those of the professed people of God." That's all. Now I want you to notice in this statement that there's a portion, and that portion is final atonement, this phrase. Ellen White speaks about a final atonement. And she does this several times in her writings, in very pertinent, important places. There are those today who deny the idea that there's a final atonement, that there's only one atonement. It was at the cross. And Ellen White speaks about the cross, and she calls it an atonement. But she calls the work in heaven the final atonement. Now, let's go to our next section. Names or sins. which will be blotted out. Because what we're going to find out is the Bible speaks about sins being blotted out, and it speaks about names being blotted out. And which one's going to be blotted out? And what will be the basis of this? So let's turn to Exodus chapter 32 and verse 32. Exodus chapter 32 and verse 32. Now, do you remember Exodus chapter 32? How does it begin? Exodus chapter 32. The people saw that Moses and Joshua had went up on the mountain. Moses had went up to get the Ten Commandments. And the people thought that Moses was a little late in getting back. And where is he at? And as for this Moses, we want not what happened to him. They said to Aaron, make us gods that will go before us. And so Aaron made a golden calf. And this golden calf, it brought great displeasure to God. And it brought great displeasure to Moses, whose heart was in harmony with God at that time. Moses was so upset that he threw down the tables of stone and broke them in front of the children of Israel, indicating that they had broken the covenant upon which which was based upon the Ten Commandments. And then he took that golden calf and he melted it down, he ground it down and put it in water and made them drink of that calf. But I want you to notice what it says now in chapter 32 and verse 32. Verse 31 also, Moses returned to the Lord and said, oh, this people have sinned a great sin and have made them gods of gold. Yet now, if thou wilt forgive their sin, and if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy book which thou hast written. The way to be kept in that book was to have your sins blotted out. And if they didn't have their sins blotted out, they would be blotted out of the book. In Great Controversy again, on page 483, it says, when any have sins remaining upon the books of records, unrepented of and unforgiven, their names will be blotted out of the book of life, and the record of their good deeds will be erased from the book of God's remembrance. Did you get that? That's important. Let me read it again. When any have sins remaining upon the books of record, unrepented of and unforgiven, their names will be blotted out of the book of life, and the record of their good deeds will be erased from the book of God's remembrance. Great Controversy, page 483. And so it's vital, friends. It's vital that we have our sins forgiven, because there will be names that will be retained in the book of life. And let's notice some texts that speak about that. In Revelation chapter 3 and verse 5, in fact, this was on our opening screen this morning. Speaking to the church of Sardis, Christ says, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. And I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Now there are those who say, well, you know, if you want to have your name in the book of life, just confess Christ. And that's what puts it there, and that's right. And then they'll say, well, if you want to keep your name there, confess your sins. And that's right. And that's true, because our sins have to be forgiven. But there's something else, friends. It says here that we must be overcomers, or our names will be blotted out of the book of life. And so let us become overcomers. What do the saints use to overcome the devil? It's found in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 11. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 11. And they overcame him, that's speaking about the devil, by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, and they love not their lives unto the death. And so they overcome by the blood of the Lamb, by all that Jesus has done, his spilled blood and his sprinkled blood, and by the word of their testimony, and they love not their lives unto death. Now what is God's wish? What does he want us to do with our sins? Let's now turn to 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9. He says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Notice there's two things here. He says, if we confess our sins, he will forgive us, yes, but he will also cleanse us. Forgiveness goes back to Leviticus chapter 4, the sin offering. The result of that atonement was one of forgiveness. But now there's another atonement, and it's the final atonement, and it's listed in Leviticus chapter 16, and that's the atonement of cleansing. Leviticus chapter 16 and verse 30, remember, you shall be clean from all your sins. And so he promises us that if we will truly confess our sins, if we repent of these sins and confess them, that we will not only be forgiven, but that we'll be cleansed. In Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 25, the Lord says, I, even I am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for my own sake, and will not remember thy sins. Now, when we think of God, we think of someone who is omnipotent, who has all power, who can do anything and everything he wants. And how can the great God of heaven forget? Surely he has all of his memories, you know, backed up in carbonite or some cloud somewhere, right? Of course, he doesn't need anything like that. But somehow, even the great God of heaven says, I will remember your sins no more. I'll never bring them up to you again. I'll never show them to the universe. They'll never be on display ever again. Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 13. Here the Bible says, he that covereth his sins shall not prosper. Do you remember who was the successor of Elijah? Who was Elijah's successor?
Elisha.
And do you remember the name of his servant?
No.
Gehazi. Greedy Gehazi. And you remember, he took some money he shouldn't have taken, and he hid it. And we see that picture of that here. And he didn't prosper. He became a leper and was finally lost. But it says here that whosoever covers his sins shall not prosper. Friends, we need our sins covered, but not covered by our own doings, not covered by our own hidings, but we need them covered by the blood of the Lamb. It says, but whoso confesses and forsaketh them shall have mercy. So we have to confess those sins, and we must also forsake those sins to have mercy. In Great Controversy on page 483, we read this: all who have truly repented of sin and by faith claim the blood of Christ as their atoning sacrifice have had pardon entered against their names in the books of heaven, as they have become partakers of the righteousness of Christ, and their characters are found to be in harmony with the law of God. Their sins will be blotted out, and they themselves will be accounted worthy of eternal life. But notice that this is predicated upon us truly repenting of our sins and by faith accepting Christ. Now, to repent means to turn around, to be sorry for, to have a godly sorrow for what you've done wrong. There are people who are sorry all the time. I remember one time my dad caught me doing some foolishness, and I tried to tell him I was sorry. All the way to get the switch. I was sorry. But you know why I was sorry? I was sorry I got caught. I was sorry I was going to get switched. I wasn't so sorry about what I'd done wrong. But friends, God wants us to have a deep sorrow that we've hurt Him, that we've broken His law, and we've let Him down in front of the whole universe. And then we can have true repentance. Now, our next section is on our advocate in the judgment. And we do have an advocate in this judgment. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 24. It says, for Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself now to appear in the presence of God for us. When someone comes in the presence of another to represent someone, that makes them an advocate. It makes them an intercessor or a mediator, and that is Jesus. In 1 John chapter 2 and verse 1, he says, my little children, these things write unto you. What things? Well, the things I just wrote about, you know, confessing your sins and you can be forgiven and cleansed from all unrighteousness. And he says, these things I've written unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. So the Bible's plan is that we don't sin. It's like when I go out and drive down the road, I don't ever plan to have a flat tire. Now, Brother Leon, he had a flat tire this last week. And a pretty bad looking place on that tire too. And the tire went down. But you know what? He had a spare tire. And in fact, Sister Annika had a flat tire the week before. But she had a spare tire in the trunk. And so they were able to fix the tire and the car could go on. You see? And so when I go out to drive, I don't plan to have a flat tire. But I have a spare just in case. And when we live our lives, friends, it's not God's plan that we sin. But if we do, if we stumble and fall along the way, if we are repentant and we ask for forgiveness, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ. In Daniel chapter 7, going back to the book of Daniel again. Daniel chapter 7 and verse 13. It says, I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And so Jesus comes near to the Ancient of Days for us so that he can be our mediator, our intercessor. In Great Controversy on page 489, it says this, He, that is Jesus, will examine the case of every individual with as close and searching scrutiny as if there was not another being upon the earth. Everyone must be tested and found without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. And so, friends, you know, we today live in a country where there's quite a large penal system, a lot going on in our courts. And sometimes people sort of get shuffled through quickly, and sometimes we think justice isn't done, or someone gets off scot-free because they just don't have time to fool with so many people. But not so in the investigative judgment. Even though it's going to involve every person who's ever accepted the name of Jesus on their lips, He's going to go through each one just as carefully as if there was not another in the universe. So on what basis will Christ confess us before His Father and His angels then? Well, let's notice what the Bible says in Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10, verses 32 and 33. Here, Martin Luther before the Diet at Worms, and where he was speaking there before those great men assembled. And it says here, Jesus says in Matthew chapter 10, verses 32 and 33 this, Whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess also before my Father which is in heaven. But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. And so that's quite a test, isn't it? And it's a simple test. But it says that when we confess Jesus before others, when we're willing to stand up and say what is right, and to do right. And to confess Jesus isn't simply just to always say, well, I believe in Jesus. But it means that we stand up for the Christian things, all the Christian principles. We stand up for the oppressed and the afflicted. We help the needy. We confess Jesus in all that we do, or we deny Him the things that we do. And Jesus says that when we stand up for Him here, and we make it boldly and proudly known that we are followers of Him, then He will honor us. I read the story of a missionary in Africa. It was in a war-torn area. And he had been working to help these people. And he and his companion, they were attacked one day by some rebels. And these rebels were anti-Christian people. And they were telling them, you must deny Jesus Christ. And that old missionary took up his Bible in his hand. He says, As long as I live, I will honor my Lord. And the man had a machete in his hand. And while the missionary had his Bible held up like that, that man took his machete and quickly hacked that man's hand off. And then he told the henchmen with him, fall upon him. And they all came upon this man and hacked him to death with their machetes. And then the leader of the group looked at this other man, this younger assistant, green assistant with him. He says, now what about you? Are you ready to throw that Bible down and spit upon it? And the man didn't say anything, and he just slowly took his coat off. And he folded that coat and handed it to the man that was making all the threats. Let me put my coat back on so I don't lose my mic here. The man looked at him in astonishment, as if, what are you doing? And the young missionary said, look, he says, this is a good coat. I paid good money for it. You take it and you get some use out of it. There's no use spilling my blood upon it. And when the man heard that, he just dropped his head and he said, how can we fight against this? And they left. And they left him. We are to confess Christ before others. In Great Controversy on page 484, it says the divine intercessor presents the plea that all who have overcome through faith in His blood be forgiven their transgressions, that they may be restored to their Eden home, and crowned as joint heirs with Himself to the first dominion, Micah 4:8. Satan, in his efforts to deceive and tempt our race, had thought to frustrate the divine plan in man's creation. But Christ now asks that this plan be carried into effect as if man had never fallen. He asks for his people not only pardon and justification, full and complete, but a share in his glory and a seat upon his throne. Great Controversy 484, it says, Christ will clothe his faithful ones with his own righteousness, that he may present them to his Father, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, Ephesians 5:27. Their names stand enrolled in the book of life, and concerning them it is written, they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 4, and that's taken from Great Controversy, page 484. So what will be the privilege of those whose names are retained in the book of life? Notice in Revelation chapter 21, and I'm going to read in verse 23, starting verse 23. And the city had no need of the sun, neither the moon, to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. And the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it, and the kings of the earth do bring their glory and honor unto it. And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations into it. And there shall in no wise enter into it anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. And Jesus says he will not blot our name out of the book of life. If we have overcome, if we have confessed our sins and forsaken those sins, then we can have a part of that great privilege. And we'll talk a little bit more about this in our next hour too. I think you'll find it to be a blessing. In Great Controversy on page 489, it says this, the intercession of Christ in man's behalf in the sanctuary above is as essential to the plan of salvation as was his death upon the cross. By his death, he began that work which after his resurrection he ascended to complete in heaven. We must by faith enter within the veil, whether the forerunner is for us entered, Hebrews 6:20. There the light from the cross of Calvary is reflected. There we may gain a clearer insight into the mysteries of redemption. But she says that this whole plan, this sanctuary, the holy, the most holy place, the process of the final atonement, the investigative judgment, it is as essential to the plan of salvation as was the death of Jesus upon the cross. Without it, friends, salvation could still not happen. And so that's one reason, and a paramount reason, why we must study what the Bible says about this, and must understand these things for ourselves. And in fact, continuing, it says, those who would share the benefits of the Savior's mediation should permit nothing to interfere with their duty to perfect holiness in the fear of God. The precious hours, instead of being given to pleasure, to display, or to gain seeking, should be devoted to an earnest, prayerful study of the Word of Truth. The subject of the sanctuary and the investigative judgment should be clearly understood by the people of God. All need a knowledge for themselves of the position and work of their great high priest. And she continues and says, otherwise, it will be impossible for them to exercise the faith which is essential at this time or to occupy the position which God designs them to fill. Every individual has a soul to save or to lose. Each has a case pending at the bar of God. Each must meet the great judge face to face. How important then that every mind contemplate often the solemn scene when the judgment shall sit and the book shall be opened, when with Daniel every individual must stand in his lot at the end of the days. And so friends, what she says here today is applicable to me, and it's applicable to you too. It's applicable to all of us. Every individual, each one of us, we have a soul to save, friends. And we're either going to be saved or we're going to be lost. There'll be no middle ground. It's either going to be black or white, friends, one day with us. We all have a case pending at the bar of God. Every one of us is going to have to face this judgment, one way or the other. And we can either have Jesus. We can either have Jesus and His blood plead our cause, or we'll have to plead our own cause and we have nothing to offer. And the wages of sin, Romans 6:23. Is death. But the Bible says that the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, one more text I'd like to look at. Because there are some people who have a great fear of this concept of an investigative judgment. That their name might just come up at any time and they're not ready. And they're going to be marked off forever. And we'll look at a specific answer to that a little bit later in our next presentation. But I want you to look at a text now in 1 John chapter 5. And I hope that it will speak volumes to your heart. 1 John chapter 5. And I'm going to start reading in verse 10. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Verse 12. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. And friends, that's as simple as it comes. If we really believe, now of course there's the text in James 2:19 that the devils believe and tremble. If that belief doesn't change us, if it doesn't actuate into good actions and good deeds, then we're no better off than the devils who believe and tremble. But if we truly believe in Jesus and we live that life of obedience that he's laid out for us, friends, we can have the hope of eternal life. We have not only simply the hope, we have the surety, we have the guarantee of eternal life. And it's true. But I pray and hope that these words have been meaningful for you today and instructive and helpful to know that we have an advocate in heaven, that we have someone who cares for us and who has died for us and now lives to make intercession for us. And so don't give up hope, no matter what you ever get involved with, no matter how difficult trials ever become. Because, friends, the Bible says in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And so he is great enough.